I saw my sons learning my behavior and treating my wife the way I treated her. And I gave them the dad lecture, you know, like you guys do, where you tell them, don't talk to your mother that way and don't act that way. And then I realized God was so clear with me in terms of the fact that I was teaching them to disrespect women. And so you need to understand that your behaviors and how you're functioning and how you treat each other, they watch and they see you. And that's not just when you think they're watching. They're watching all the time. Moms and dads, thanks for taking some time to listen to us share today. We want to tell you a little bit about our relationship and how what we've experienced might help you see some warning signs for maybe your teens in their dating relationship or younger kids. Maybe also think a bit about how your relationship is and how what kind of role models you're providing for your kids. Our story involves me being a pretty insecure, anxious guy who wanted to control things because it made me feel better to not be out of control. And that insecurity led me to be very dominant and manipulative with Jan. And it created a scenario for many years in our marriage where I wasn't honoring and respecting her, and she was feeling very much like she was less than me in the marriage, and that created a really difficult situation for you.
Just a little bit about our history. We dated for about 4 days and got engaged, and we're married 4 months later, and in May we celebrate 35 years together. So it has been a challenge, and we have really worked hard to go from him being a controlling person to a recovering controlling person. So there still are moments of the insecurity and wanting to protect everybody in the family, to being a little less worried about things like that, that are sometimes out of your control.
A lot of times partners who are controlling and dominant end up doing that because they're scared about what might happen if they don't. They are okay with controlling situations because they see decisions as win-lose kind of propositions. It's not just a matter of really trying to communicate with your partner. You're trying to convince them of what you want to do. An example might be that there are times when I'm having a conversation with Jan, and in my mind, I'm really thinking about what I would like the end result to be. And that's not a very healthy way to have a conversation. What I should be doing is trying to start an interaction to be able to get to a point where when we're done, we both love each other, honor each other, respect each other, we feel good about each other, we're closer to God, and we feel like we have handled that well. And I think we're gonna be able to share some insights with you as parents about what you might look for in some of your kids and their dating relationships. And partly we want you to think about your relationship as well. When you're making decisions, is it balanced? Is it fair? Do both partners kind of trade off and get their way? Or are decisions largely made one way or the other? Is there one partner who kind of tends to be the dominant one? And is that the way you want it to be? You know, it doesn't have to be that way if you don't want it to be.
Yes, in our relationship, sometimes you can see the controlling person is they're always bringing up issues. And they're always trying to get their point across, whether you want to hear it or not, or whether it's a good time for you to be interrupted. So I think really finding that time where it works for both people and how you present what you want, the issue that you want to talk about. If your partner is kind of mean and saying not kind things, if you put it in a different way, I have piles, the junk pile and stuff, and he's much better at it now than he was.
I have color-coded stickers on everything. It's all organized. So.
Very organized. And if he's like, gosh, just pick up your stuff, versus, hey, hon, I know you've been really busy and, your pile is kind of growing on its own. So do you mind? Do you have a little bit of time where you could do that? And I try to do it. It always comes back, so it's not my fault. But it's in how you present things to the partner makes a huge difference in the outcome of your conversation.
So let's share a few points that we might think that you as a mother or father working with your teenagers or your younger kids might be able to pay attention to and be aware of. One thing that you could look at is to see how your child communicates with you. Do they talk over you? Do they interrupt you? Do they, I mean, I know most 12-year-olds, 15-year-olds, it's all about them, right? But still, if they're not really listening to what you have to say, they're probably not doing that with anyone else either. If you see them hanging out with their friends and they seem to be the one ordering other people around, or they tell the group what they're going to do, those are signs to pay attention to. And if you happen to have a relationship, if anything we just mentioned about our story resonates with you and there's some power and control issues in your marriage, then you need to understand they're probably learning from you. I saw my sons learning my behavior and treating my wife the way I treated her. And I gave them the dad lecture, you know, like you guys do, where you tell them, don't talk to your mother that way and don't act that way. And then I realized God was so clear with me in terms of the fact that I was teaching them to disrespect women. And so you need to understand that your behaviors and how you're functioning and how you treat each other, they watch and they see you. And that's not just when you think they're watching. They're watching all the time, right? So one sign to look for is disrespectful behavior on the part of your child to other people. Now that would be for a son. What might be something that they could look at in their daughter that might make them be concerned that they were okay being controlled?
Part of it depends on the age. If they're just starting to date, one of the signs that I would look for is isolation, mm-hmm. where they're no longer hanging out with their other friends, that they're only spending time with that partner or the boyfriend or girlfriend, depending on who's in that situation. To me, that's kind of the first thing, and that your daughter does not have a voice in the relationship. If she wanted something to go somewhere or do something, and they don't end up doing it because he wanted to do something else. So I think isolation mm-hmm. and not having a voice in mm-hmm. the relationship. And again, how they speak to your child.
Mm-hmm. And as Jan said, it could be either way. The girl or the boy could be the controlling partner. It's not specifically by any means just a gender thing. But another sign you could look for would be to see how decisions are made or how they end up coming to a decision about something they need to do. Like, are they going to go to a dance, or where are they going to go on a date, or what I've seen with couples I work with, because I'm a marriage and family therapist, so I work with a lot of couples and families. And I see oftentimes in young relationships, I hear about things like choices of colleges even get made based on what the other partner wants. So I've worked with couples at a young age who have been making decisions about where they're going to get their education and what their career will be based on, well, Johnny, what do you think I should be? Or Susie, what do you think would be best? And then they're deferring to their partner's choice about their career. Those are really dangerous signs, because that means they're so insecure about their own choices that they're wanting someone else to make those choices for them.
And to continue that relationship. And sometimes it's not a healthy relationship, but it can be. That I think a lot of people feel when you see something that's not right, that they just need to go get away or stop seeing this person. Mm-hmm. As you get older and you're more committed to relationships, it's not something you necessarily want to throw away. We've worked very hard at becoming better at, or really you, for not being controlling anymore. And it's made a world of difference. There's so many other great qualities about my husband. That was something that was very difficult for us. And you can have the journey, you can transform, you can change and make the relationship what you want it to be.
The patterns that you're seeing form in your younger children and your adolescent children can be locked in pretty quickly. Jan's childhood formed the patterns that she created and how she brought the baggage she brought to our marriage. And my childhood, with my mom being a pretty anxious person, kind of glass half empty kind of person, my dad having some anger problems, being a pretty strong individual, and my pushing back at him a lot, those patterns formed what I become. So you need to, as parents, we need to have conversations with our kids. We need to talk to them. We need to talk about their relationships. It's hard with our boys. We have two boys. One's older, one's younger now. One's 30, one's 22. 31 and 22. And in both those situations, I've had to have long conversations with them about the example I set, some of the mistakes I made, talk with them about what I see in their relationships with their partners now. It's okay to talk to your kids about their relationships. I want you to hear that. It's not bad. I mean, they're going to say, Mom, Dad, come on. You don't need to ask me about this. It's fine. That's what every adolescent says, right? It's fine. Everything's great.
We're happy.
But if you can open that conversation and they can talk to you about these deep feelings, then maybe they'll be able to feel safe talking to their partner, talking to you when they get older and they think about marriage and you know, commitment. So I certainly want you all to hear that it's important that you talk about the things we're talking about today with you and that you open those conversations with your kids.
And along that same line, you don't want to try and have a conversation if they're playing Xbox or Wii or whatever, and they're just like, yeah, okay, fine, whatever. So taking a walk, spending set aside time.
Going out to dinner always worked with our boys because as long as there was food involved, they liked to listen.
Yeah, so. And they couldn't get away
right?
Because we had the car key. So until they got driving, then
they had to wait till the meal came at least, right? So.
Or take it to go. But find what works for you. And it's important that you engage fully. You're not on your phone. We're so pulling out our phones if it's something gets boring and, you know, no phones, conversation. Mm-hmm. And if you start setting that pattern earlier, then they'll always be able to come to you and say, hey, can we go out to dinner? I want to talk to you about a few things. So you establish a pattern. I kind of have a funny, when Ron was in kindergarten or first grade, his teacher would have to pull him from recess because he was always telling the other kids they weren't playing the games right. So as a very young person, he was trying to organize, no, you got to do this. And they were like, oh, I don't have to.
So you can see those signs in your kids that are pretty early
age.
We
see it in our grandson. So, yes. And Britt, our oldest, would say, Dad, I'm going to get the mail. Do you want to send the CIA or the FBI to follow me? So that kind of gives you an idea of things that he had to overcome and that did affect our kids in some ways.
I think it's important that you realize and be aware of the fact that your kids need to have some guidance. It's okay to talk to them about a model of relationship and a model of marriage. Take Ephesians 5, talk through it with them, explain to them that there are good godly patterns of what positive, strong relationships look like. Explain terms like submission and talk to them about it and say, you know, this is what we really think God's trying to tell us, because we do have guidance in the Bible for what relationships should look like. So my final point to you is to really make certain we want you to hear that it's okay to have these conversations. It's important to give them a model of what relationships should look like, and that God has provided that for us so that we can give them the guidance to build their relationships healthy and strong at a very early age, before the patterns become problematic. And there's hope for change. We are living proof that God can do miracles in relationships.
Yes.
But boy, it would sure be nice if you as parents could work with them early and kind of do some preventive medicine. And that's what our message is to you today.
Yes, because it's so important that you establish things that as role models that they see. So many times kids don't have that and they're kind of left trying to find their own way. And sometimes some of those patterns aren't healthy. And, you know, for your daughters or your sons who are not in great relationships at this time, doesn't mean that they can't be, but they need some guidance. And definitely counseling is always something to help sort things out, so you're not the only person necessarily speaking into their situation, that they can have other people as well, pastors, other things.
Thanks for listening to us today. I do want to remind you that if you're not the person teaching your kids about relationships, then their peers are and their friends are. So if you want this to be something that happens between you and God and your kids, we really feel strongly that you would be probably a better role model than their peers. So we hope our message suggest to you that it's okay and it's important and it's valuable to talk with your kids about relationships and give them a strong model of biblical relationship that they can work through. Thanks for listening to us.
Thank you.